Hey, welcome. So this talk is about Cypher on Apache Spark, and this is our project we were working on, and we call it Morpheus. And let me introduce ourselves first. So this is Martin, my colleague, and I'm Sören, and we're engineers for Neo4j, working out of Germany, and we're both developers on this Morpheus project I just mentioned. So let's get started. So we at Neo4j, we like to say that graphs are everywhere. So it turns out that many real-world use cases are actually a graph. And it starts, for example, you can see it on the left with networks like Facebook, or the internet, for example, is also a network kind of. And you can do analysis or queries to extract data or like choke points or something in a network. And on the right side, that's an interesting use case. So Neo4j was helping with the so-called Panama Papers, and we tried, so, or the people in the Panama Papers tried to obfuscate their connection to other companies. And this is actually also a graph. And when you view the data as a graph, you can easily see those connections or extract those connections. So the graph space is actually growing. This chart is from dbengines.com. They use Stack Overflow questions and mentions in other public spaces to extract the popularity of a database. And this is actually a relative growth in this space. So you can see on the bottom, the red line is relational databases. They are equally popular throughout the years. Doesn't mean that they're not popular at all, but this is like the relative growth in this field. Spark is also coming, graphs are also coming to Spark with Spark 3.0. So we have a thing called the SPIP, which is a Spark improvement proposal, and the community voted yes on having Spark in graphs and Spark 3.0. So this will come later this summer, and you will get query capabilities. You can run Cypher on property graphs. And what Cypher and property graphs is, I will just explain. So, at first, you might be distracted. So on the lower batch, it says Spark AI. And we actually had this talk earlier last week at the Spark AI Summit. So this one is actually a shorter version of what we just told there. And we will skip a few parts, I think, depending on the time. Has anybody not heard of a property graph here? Okay, at least one. So a property graph is essentially a normal graph, but with properties attached to it. And properties are, you can imagine them as a key and a value, like key value stores. And a graph consists of nodes, and nodes are normally like real world entities you want to express in a model, like persons or car in this example. And they can have the so-called properties. So for example, the person on the upper left has the name Dan. And connections between nodes are called relationships. For example, in this example, the person Dan is in love or loves another person, which name is N. And relationships can also have properties, like Dan drives a car since 2011. And this is kind of the property graph. And in Neo4j, we have we invented a query language that is called Cypher. And Cypher is or tries to extract data from this graph, like much like SQL, but on graphs. So the central concept in Cypher is the so-called pattern matching. So we try to define a pattern graph that we search in our bigger graph. And you can see it here On the middle part, we have this pattern graph as a visualization. We have Dan loves and a question mark on the right side. That means we want to extract what this question mark is. And in Cypher, we use the match keyword and so-called ASCII art to express what we are looking for. An ASCII art means here, for example, we use round parentheses to mimic what a node kind of looks like, and we use arrows for relationships for directed graphs. And what this query says is we want to get all nodes that have a label person with the name Dan that love another node, and whom is actually a variable here, and we want to find every pattern that satisfies this query pattern and return every connected node, also every node that is loved by Dan, and we return that.
So, do you have namespaces there?
Sorry?
Namespaces, do you have?
Question was if we have namespaces. I don't know exactly what you mean with namespace.
Defining rules for the names. That's what you mean by space.
Rules for the names?
Yeah, like
it's
the way you.
Can you repeat that? And
I'm not going to put word in his mouth, but normally setting up a space is defining the rules by which you do the data types, definition characteristics, the way they are formed, what they are related to, that sort of things. That's what I mean by space.
The way we make the URL sometimes like library.google.com, like one namespace. Yeah. So Martin just is going to describe this later. But what you can do is, for example, you can have multiple labels on a node, which are kind of a namespace. So you can have a broader category, like person is maybe a broader category. You could have another label that is like the name of the person could also be a label, for example. Yeah, it's not really a wildcard, but yeah, kind of. You can have multiple labels and define your namespace with that. Okay, so on the general landscape, so we have transactional systems that perform on tables, so like Postgres, SQL, I think everybody has heard of it. And on the other hand, we have on the lower row analytics platforms like Spark SQL, and Spark SQL is also operating on tables in a distributed fashion. And we at Neo4j try to mimic this on the graph space. So, for example, our database, Neo4j database, is a transactional graph database. And for the analytics part of it, the lower right tile here, we try to fill it with Morpheus, what we are going to talk about right now. So, just to wrap up a bit, Spark is immutable, has immutable data structures, and this means So we are composing graphs out of data frames, so out of immutable data frames, and that means we are also bound to the capabilities that Spark have. So we can transform graphs and we can combine them, but we cannot add arbitrary nodes, for example. And what we do, we basically compile our query to Spark SQL that then gets optimized by Catalyst. And on the other side, there's Neo4j. Neo4j is a transactional native graph database. And native means it has data structures optimized for graphs. So in Spark, for example, when we have this connection between two nodes, we use joins to follow these connections. And in Neo4j, we would use pointers, which is a lot faster. And with Morpheus, actually, we try to get data from Spark to Neo4j and back, so that you have a big store, a big processing engine, but you can, if you want, load it into Neo4j and have the full power of graphs, so to say. Our message we want to convey here is actually tables and graphs are both useful models. We don't say like graphs are better than tables. And what Morpheus does is we say it parallels Spark SQL. So it's built above Spark SQL. And you can see that, for example, we have a so-called Cypher session. And Cypher session is actually a wrapper around a Spark session. And when we use, for example, a Cypher query and get a result, we can also perform SQL queries on top of the result. So we have both in space. And so what are the typical use cases for Morpheus? So we have data integration, as I just told earlier. For example, if you want to load a graph or a subgraph into Neo4j and you want to process it, you can do this with much more data, like as much data as Spark can handle. And you can, of course, execute distributed Cypher queries, much as like you can do with Spark SQL, with SQL queries. And the newest field we try to target is data science. So we have a native graph algorithms library in Neo4j. And you can use Morpheus to load a graph into this library as well. And just a few algorithms on this page. Graph algorithms on the top left, there's pathfinding and search, and this is, I think, the most one of the most prominent ones. This is like shortest path queries. And importance algorithms are, for example, PageRank. So a visualization of what you can do in Morpheus, actually. You can see Morpheus here in the middle, and we try to create a graph in Morpheus. And we can do this by composing different tables coming out of Spark, for example. And tables in Spark can come from in-memory tables, from file formats. We could define a hive over some JSON files, for example. Or we can connect Spark via JDBC to a relational database and get tables out of it and compose graphs of it. But we can as well load graphs from Neo4j, for example, or we can load graphs that we store with Morpheus later. And like I just said, and so property graphs that come out of Morpheus are actually composed tables, so they consist of data frames. And so this is like a data flow you can imagine when working with Morpheus or with Spark 3.0. So we start off with a property graph, and we can run a Cypher query. And on the lower path here, you can see that a possible result of a Cypher query is a data frame, for example. But on the upper path, there's also the capability to get another graph back. And in this graph, you can, of course, execute another Cypher query. And the output of this is, again, a graph or a data frame. And on data frames, you can, of course, execute SQL queries. Or you can even transform the data frame to another Spark library, like mllib, for example, and run machine learning. Yes?
So this is just for Neo4j and Spark, that's it.
Can you?
This is just for Neo4j and Spark, that's it.
So property graphs here are coming out of Morpheus or of the Spark 3.0 graph capabilities.
Right, but any other is not open to any other graph databases or?
No, we just target Neo4j. And what you can see here is like the analytics workflow also starting with a property graph. And we can, for example, use the data frames that this graph consists of and execute our normal Spark jobs that we that we defined earlier on it. And what we get out is, of course, again, a data frame. Or on the upper pass here, we can write the property graph to the Neo4j graph algos library and perform some algorithms on it. And we get out another property graph, and we can process this like recursively, as you could imagine. And the last capability is we can use the property graph stored in Spark, and with Morpheus we can write it to Neo4j and persist it in Neo4j, or we can persist it as on disk as a file-based format. And we do this using we have a thing called a well-known directory structure, so we can put a graph there which has two directories, nodes, relationships, and we can basically retrieve it from disk again. And I think my part is finished with that. Over to you.
Yeah, hi, I'm Martin, also engineer at Neo4j, working on Morpheus since 2 years now. And I will talk about the architecture. And Morpheus basically consists of four modules or four components, which is the Scala API that you use to run Cypher on Spark. Then we have the so-called property graph catalog, which is very similar to the SQL catalog. So it allows you to manage multiple graphs, which is a feature that Morpheus introduces. Then we have the concept of property graph data sources that you use to connect to, for example, Neo4j, as Soren mentioned, or to relational databases, Hive, or just files. And you use those data source, property graph data sources, to read and write graphs. And then there's the query engine that basically takes a Cypher query and translates it into Spark SQL API calls. Yes?
These are very good slides. Are they publicly available?
Yes. So as Soren already said, this talk, I gave this talk with our product manager last week at Spark Summit in San Francisco, and it was recorded, and the slides are also available online. And I think I can also share them after the meetup. Another question, yeah?
So no Python API?
So that's a good question about the Python API. So as Soren said, we are currently working on bringing a subset of Morpheus into Spark 3.0. And in order to do that, we need to provide Python APIs. And so we will introduce Python APIs for Spark 3.0 so that you can use Python to run Cypher on Spark. And we're also planning to add Python API to Morpheus. But at the moment, we don't have one. Okay, continue then. So let's look a little bit into the technical details. On the top left, you see a Cypher query where we just basically look for a captain that commands a ship, and the captain's name is Morpheus, and we want to know what the captain's name is and the ship's name is. This is basically a very simple Cypher query to find out those relations. And we take this Cypher query and put it into the so-called Open Cypher frontend, which is a module that we share with the Neo4j database, which is basically responsible for parsing, rewriting, normalization of the query. And the output of that is an abstract syntax tree, AST in short, which is basically the input to the Morpheus system. On the right-hand side of the slide, you see four stages of query planning that we have in Morpheus. The first one is the so-called intermediate language. As you all know, Spark SQL is a schema-fixed model, which means you have to define your columns and your data types. And a property graph, on the other hand, doesn't have a schema, and which means we have to infer a schema from either the data or the user gives it to us. So that's what basically what happens in the intermediate language is that we type the expressions inside the Cypher query. So we have to know, for example, that c.name is a string, which is the property of the captain node. And if we have our typed representation of the query, we forward this to logical planning phase, which basically translate this IR representation into graph-like operators. So for example, a logical graph operator expand that basically looks up all the neighbors of a given node. And we do some basic logical optimization, like some column pruning and predicate pushdowns. And this logical optimized plan is then handed over to the relational planning phase, where we translate the graph query operators into relational operators. So for example, the expand operation that we see in the query, where we look for captain that commands a ship, is basically translated into two joins between the captain table, the commands table, and the ship table. That's a kind of easy way to imagine what happens there. And this relational operations are executed on an abstract table, which is a relational table with relational operations. And then we have the Spark backend that actually implements this abstract table with data frames. So you might imagine that there are also other backends possible. So for example, we have one for Apache Flink and also for just Scala collections to run it locally. And for the Spark case, however, we just take this data frame implementation of our query and hand it over to Spark SQL. Catalyst is responsible for code-based or rule-based query optimization on the SQL level, and then Spark Core executes the query in a distributed way. So how are graphs represented within the system? We have this concept called tables for labels. As Soren explained in the beginning, a property graph has nodes and relationships, and nodes can have one or more labels. And relationships always have a single relationship type. And for each label combination, which is like a set of labels that exist on some nodes, we have a node table. And for each relationship type, we have a relationship table. And those tables are then represented by data frames, and which means they require a fixed schema, which is why we introduced the concept called graph type, which is very similar to, you can also call it graph schema. And inside this graph type, we basically know what are the label combinations, so the labels that occur together, and what are the relationship types in our graph, and what are their properties, and what are the data types of those properties. Let's have a look at an example. On the left-hand side, we have a very simple graph where a node, Morpheus, is connected to a ship, Nebuchadnezzar, which he commands. And so we have two nodes tables here, one node table that represents all the nodes that have the labels captain and person. We have a second node table that represents all the nodes that have label ship. And we have a third table, which is a relationship table that represents all relationships that have the relationship type commands. And of course, the rows then are the data. And we have system-specific columns for IDs, source and target, which connect two nodes onto the relationship. Then on the right-hand side, we see a kind of JSON-like representation of the graph type, which you can also call schema. So here we say that captain person, all nodes that have labels captain person have property called name, and this property has a type string. And we support all the cipher types, which you might know from Neo4j. Yes?
Why didn't you just leave it captain only and you added a person sub?
This was just, so the question is why I used two labels here. It's basically to highlight the fact that nodes can have multiple labels, and that that I show that, for example, if we had another node that has, for example, just captain, this would be a different node table. So all the rows in this captain person table do have exact those two labels. Right, so just to summarize this architecture overview, we have the query coming in, gets into Morpheus, we do the relational planning, which outputs a relational plan, which could look like the one on the right-hand side, some projections, some joins, and this is basically executed on a property graph, which is represented, by, like I said, by tables, which are backed by data frames in the Spark implementation. Right, let's talk a little bit about the query features of Morpheus. So I guess most of you know Neo4j and maybe also know Cypher. And Cypher 9 is kind of the version that we have in Neo4j, which is currently implemented in the Neo4j 3.5. And the Open Cypher specification basically, or this Open Cypher standard kind of defines how the language is constructed. So we have a grammar there. And what's also interesting is that Neo4j is not the only implementer of OpenCypher. There are also other vendors that use Cypher in their systems. And there's, for example, also the Cypher for Kremlin project, which is quite interesting. So, and in Morpheus, we basically just support the read part of Cypher because we don't do any CRUD operations. We just, don't create and update and delete operations. We just do reading and transformation. And by transformations, we can create new graphs, which I will show next, which also allows you to basically create new things, but not in a way as you would do it in a Neo4j transactional database. So Cypher 10 is kind of the new version of Cypher. It has multiple features, and one of them is the support for having multiple graphs. So in Neo4j, as you might know, you only have like a single property graph that describes your whole database. And if you run a query on this property graph, you return a table. And with Cypher 10, we propose multiple graph features, which means that the query can run on multiple graphs or can support multiple graphs as input, and can also, and this is very important, support return new graphs. And if your query or your language takes a graph as input and returns a graph, you can basically compose multiple queries to describe data flows, for example. Right, so like I said, we also have the catalog, which I will explain on a few slides later. So let's have a look at an example here. So the blue part is basically the language feature that is in Morpheus, one of them, and the not blue part, maybe it's black or dark blue, is Cypher 9. So here in this query, we are basically looking for friends of a friend, which is FOAF. So we're looking of friends that are connected to the friends of Dan, and we want to just return their names and order them by name. So this is a Cypher 9 query. And here in this query, you basically show that you can run this query on a specific graph, which is identified by the name social network. So there could be multiple graphs, but we are choosing this one. So here the input is a property graph and the output is a table, as you note from Neo4j. In this query, we again run this query on a specific graph, but we don't return a table, we return a new graph, because what we do here is we are looking for friends of persons, and we select those that are not already connected. So if my friend has another friend and I don't know this other friend, then this is basically a recommendation, which we call possible friend here. So what we do in the construct clause that you see here, we create a new relationship with the relationship type possible friend between the person and the friend of a friend that he's not already connected to, and return this as a new graph. The graph that is being returned here just contains the two persons and the possible friend relationship. You can also do something like here in the construct clause, you see the construct on feature, which means that we add this relationship in the create clause on top of those two graphs. So it's construct on social network and products, for example, creates a graph union and also adds the new relationship here. This query, for example, runs basically on two input graphs. Here we take persons from a social network and customers from a products graph, and do a value join on an identifying property, which is the email address, which is basically a way to integrate those two independent graphs into a single graph and then use this, for example, for further recommendation queries. And with Cypher 10 and Morpheus, we also introduced the concept of graph views, which is very similar to views from SQL. So you can basically store a specific query under a given name, and the view takes some arguments. So for example, here we define a view called young friends that takes a graph argument, and on that graph we select basically persons that are connected to each other. So and they are both under 25 years old, and then we basically create a graph that only contains those persons that we just queried for. Sorry, question?
Yes, yeah, so it's not kind of confusing that sometimes when in the where you use that and then in the match you use column?
The question is if it's confusing to use where clauses and the colon in the notes?
In the where B1.h or B2.h.
Yes.
In the match,
yeah.
In the query, use
yeah.
B1 column person.
Right. So the label predicate that we are using here, label predicates are expressed by this colon directly on the variable. This is just like the way we decided to design this, and everything else like matches on properties can be either constructed or either defined in the where clause as you see it here, or I think we saw an earlier example like this one where, for example, we are looking for nodes that we are not interested in the label, so we basically scan all the nodes, but we have a predicate on the name property here. So you can also inline those predicates, but normally if you write nice cipher queries, you would extract those more complex predicates into the where clause and just keep the label predicates like person, for example, in the node definition. Yeah, that's how you typically do it. You could also say, for example, there's a function called labels, so you could say where labels p1 contains person. Could also be another way of expressing this. Right, this is just how we supply those views. I will just go over this now. Right, how much time do we actually have? I'm asking the organizers, actually. Okay, a couple hours, cool. So this talk was designed for 90 minutes, and yeah, we have like, to finish this talk, we would need 70 minutes maybe. So, who's for hands-on labs? I mean, just show some code, or do you want to just get the concept, get the ideas, talk about Spark 3.0, or want to talk about graph analytics, graph algorithms in Spark and Neo4j? Those are basically the three things that are coming up. So I can show a lot of code if you want. I can show how we integrate Morpheus and Neo4j and graph algorithms, or I could talk about the SPIP, which is the Spark 3.0 proposal. Okay, let's do some stuff with some code and see how it goes. So we have a very big demo here, which is basically separated into five parts. And in the first part, I will show using a common data set or a publicly available data set, the Yelp data set, how you can use this to create a property graph and how to persist this. And then we go over to building some library of graphs, and then we do some querying and integrate Neo4j. So Yelp is a local search service, as you all know, and it's basically a data set that is available online, and it contains users with some properties, and those users write reviews about some businesses that also have some properties, and the reviews also have properties. So it's a property graph, and here's a little snapshot how such a graph could look like, or this is basically what we focus on. And what we want to do in this third, in this first part of the demo is we want to use the JSON files that you get if you download the Yelp dataset. Then we want to just create some node and relationship tables that represent the reviews, the users, and the businesses. And then we create a property graph and store it in the file system. One concept I need to explain first is the concept of how do we actually create a node table or relationship table. When you have your data frame, which you see in the first line, this is just default Spark SQL, Spark read JSON to load JSON files into a data frame, and then you can do just Spark SQL operations like select. So you have your data frame, which is the user data frame, and what we need in order to hand this into Morpheus is a so-called node mapping or a relationship mapping, which is basically some metadata that the user has to provide in order to describe what's actually contained in the data frame. So here, for example, we have to specify what is the primary key column, which is ID, which is node mapping builder on ID. We have to say what is the label of all the rows that are contained in that data frame. As you can see, we don't have an additional column that stores the label information, so this is just implied information. And then we specify what are the property keys, and we assume one-to-one mapping between the property name and the column. You can also have a custom mapping there. And then we just use this mapping and the data frame to create, for example, a node table. And how does it look in IntelliJ? So, all right, I forgot to mention that this is all available on GitHub. So Morpheus is open source, and the demo is available under this link. If you go to OpenCypher Morpheus on GitHub, then you will find it. Right, so so there's a Yelp demo, and this is basically the five parts that we might want to go over, or maybe some of it. And what I also have here is the Yelp data set, which is just JSON files that you can download, like I said. And what we want to do first is we want to import this data, and the import is basically separated into three steps. We at first create some tables that is just raw Spark SQL. Sorry, I have to do this. Is this readable? Cool. So this is just a Spark SQL API that we use to load those JSON files into data frames. We do some selects because we are not interested in all of the columns. And then we just create a case class that wraps those the three data frames to make it simpler for further processing. And in the second step, with those three data frames, we create a property graph. And this is basically what I just showed on the slide. We create, for example, the user node table by creating the node mapping for the user. Same for businesses and same for the relationships. The only difference between node and relationships is that we have to also specify which column contains the start node ID and which column contains the end node ID. And instead of a label, we specify the relationship type. And then we can also say what are the properties. One thing that I want to mention at this point is, for example, we have this function here, prepend ID column. So there is a constraint, which is that all the nodes, so all the identifiers, node identifiers have to be unique across all nodes, and all the relationship identifiers have to be unique across all relationships. A simple way to achieve this is, for example, just to prepend the label or the relationship type to the ID. Because normally, if you load data from CSV files or from relational tables, the ID is only unique within the table, right? So if you have a primary key, which is auto-increment or whatever, then you might have collisions between multiple tables. And in order to avoid this, we prepend the label here to make them globally unique. But that's something that you need to take care of if you're using this API to construct graphs. If you're using property graph data sources, there are ways that the system handles this for you, which I will talk about later. So now we have those three tables, business node table, user node table, and the relationship table for the reviews. And we just say Morpheus graphs create. Morpheus is basically this Morpheus session on top here, which you can just for demo purposes run locally. It spawns a Spark session, and you can also access the Spark session from Morpheus, as you can see here. So Soren already said that we wrap a Spark session. Right, so I won't run this now because it takes a while on this. I think it's 10 gigabyte data set and we don't have that much time, but I can show you how this looks on disk. So here on the left-hand side, is this visible? I hope so. We have the graph called Yelp. This is just the name under which we store this graph. And it is partitioned into a nodes directory and relationships directory. And within there, we have the nodes partitioned by their label combination or the label sets, and the relationships partitioned by their relationship type. There's also the schema that I talked about, which is the graph type. Here, for example, we say we have labels user. User have properties string. The question mark is that this is a nullability, so which means that the name can be null. We have the Yelping since, which is a date type, and then we have the elite status, which is a sequence of years in which the user was an elite user, which is a list of integers. Same for the businesses and for the relationships. So that's something the system generates if you store the graph, and this is also something that we require in order to read it again. So this is basically how this is what we call the well-known directory structure. So each file-based data source that we have basically writes into this format. That the only difference is how we store it. So this is Parquet, for example. There's one for org and one for CSV. Right, so let's go back to the slides and talk about how we actually manage multiple graphs. So now we have seen how we create a single graph. And now we want to talk about the property graph catalog. So in the Cypher session or Morpheus session, we have a catalog, and a catalog can handle so-called property graph data sources. A property graph data source is identified by a namespace, and the property graph data source can handle multiple property graphs. So the qualified graph name is basically the concatenation of the namespace and the graph name to uniquely identify a graph within the catalog. So the Cypher session, which is the top trait, is your entry point. It allows you to run Cypher by giving query string. And you can also use a driving table, which is interesting. So you can have a previous SQL result and use this as a driving table for your Cypher query. And you can, of course, access the catalog. The catalog itself is like one level down. So the session has a catalog, and the catalog is able to register or deregister property graph data sources under given namespace. And you can store and retrieve graphs given their qualified graph name, which is the namespace plus the graph name. And the property graph data source basically mirrors those methods, but only on the graph name, because the property graph data source itself is registered under namespace. So what are the available property graph data sources? We already saw that we can store into the file into the file system, which is the file-based property graph data source, supports parquet.org CSV and writes to everything Spark can write to. Supports multiple graphs, reading and writing. Then the most advanced one is basically the SQL property graph data source, which we might talk about a little bit at least, which allows you to load property graphs from relational databases, either using JDBC, so you can connect to any JDBC compliant database, or using Hive. And there are two Neo4j property graph data sources, one that is using Bolt, which is Neo4j's own binary protocol for network transfer, and you can run using this one to a running Neo4j database. And we have the Neo4j bulk import that basically dumps a property graph into a Neo4j specific import format, and that allows you to create an offline Neo4j database. It's the fastest way of writing a Neo4j database. So how does it look when we have our queries? So on the left-hand side, we have an instance of such a catalog. So there's the namespace social net, and we register the Neo4j property graph data source under this namespace. And within the property graph data source, we have a graph with the name US. And in order to actually point to this graph and bring it into the context, we say from socialnet.us, and then we're gonna match all the persons and just return them. So this is how you address a graph within the catalog using a Cypher query. Then, as you can imagine, if you have multiple namespaces, so for example here we have social net and products, which can hold graphs in different data sources. So one graph is in Neo4j, other graphs are in SQL. And so here in this query, it's the same one that we had before. We get all the persons from a Neo4j graph, which is called socialnet.us, and then we get all the products from a graph that is stored in SQL, which is called products 2018. And then we match persons and customers on their email address and bring them together. So this is basically like a federated query system. Oh, sorry, question.
How do you deal with versions?
You mean yes. So the question is versions of the graph. So those graphs are immutable, which means that if you load the graph, and for example at the relationship you have to create a new graph or you override the existing one. So there's no versioning scheme implemented at this point. Right. So for example, here we actually create a new graph. There's a Cypher syntax for that, which is catalog create graph, socialnet.us new, which means we want to store this new graph in Neo4j, which is the namespace that we are using here, socialnet, and the new graph name is us new, which is basically the joint graph between those social network and the products graph. We create a new relationship between customers and persons that have the same email address. We call that relationship same as, and this graph is then stored in Neo4j under the new graph name and can be accessed in another query. Right, same for the views. I will just skip this. Okay, so another. Yeah, sure.
So if you have products 2017, 2018, you are going to have so many clashes, right?
Clashes? What do you mean?
Like products that they are not new, they are the same.
Right, but they are replicated. So I can show you, we have the next example basically shows exactly this case.
My question is, you can deal with that, right?
Yes, yeah. So, right, the next example is basically, and this is one of the major use cases that we use Morpheus for, is to manage multiple snapshots of graphs, like what we call graph protections. So in this example, again, we have the Yelp data set. And what we want to do here is we want to at first just extract the subgraph of Yelp for a specific city, which is Boulder City. And then for the years 2015 to 2018, we want to construct multiple projections of this graph. So for example, on the bottom left, we have a projection business co-reviewed business, which means we connect two businesses if they have been reviewed by the same user. And the same for the users. A user is a co-reviews with another user if they both review the same business, which is another projection. And then the third one is basically a combination of the second one and the original graph. And how does this look like? So we go back to the graph library. So what we do here, we again have our Morpheus session. And we here, what we do is we register a property graph data source under a given namespace. That's the data source that we use to actually to store the graph in the first part. Namespace is called file system. And what you see here is basically the factory that allows you to create property graph data sources. So graph sources.fs .parquet creates file system based property graph data sources. There are multiple options here, like Cypher, which creates Neo4j data sources, and SQL, which creates the mentioned SQL property graph data sources. And all these take different configurations. But here we take the file system one because that's the one that we used to store the graph in the first place. And so with the first query, we basically query the subgraph that is just containing reviews and businesses from a specific city, which is Boulder City. It's just a parameter here. So you can just fork this and play around with it if you want. And we basically copy this graph by recreating a new graph that just contains the users, the reviews, and the businesses for that particular city. And since we are building multiple projections out of this graph, we might want to cache it because, as you know, in Spark, if you run multiple transformations on a data frame, you should cache it in order to avoid recomputing it all the time. So it's basically the same concept here. You can call cache on this graph. And then we have our loop that basically goes over those years that you are interested in and creates the projections. The first one is just the same, the subgraph of Boulder City for that particular year, which we do just for speeding up the projections that come afterwards. So we basically extract all the businesses and reviews and users where the review date is of year 2015, for example. So as you can see here, we can easily access also datetime properties and their particular components like the year. And from this graph, we create the different projections. So for example, here we see the business co-reviewed business projection, which is basically a business that has been reviewed by a specific user. And this user reviewed another business, business two. We limit this for the specific year. And then with the first business and the second business and the number of users that reviewed both businesses, it's kind of a grouping what we do here. We create a new relationship. Business one has been co-reviewed with business two by a certain amount of users, which we store as a property on the relationship. So two businesses are connected, and the connection itself stores the number of users that have reviewed both businesses, which can be used for an edge weight, for example, for some algorithm that we want to run on later. So we have the other projections. I don't want to go into detail on this now. You can just have a look if you are interested. Right, so I think I will quickly go over the SQL property graph data source depending on interest and time. Okay. So the actual idea here is to basically translate data from one world, which is SQL tables or data stored in relational database systems, or for example in Hive, into the property graph world. And for this, we have the so-called SQL property graph data source, which is responsible for actually performing this translation. And it is driven, or it's configured by a so-called graph DDL, which is a data definition language, which brings us to the topic of schema that is typically not related to property graphs. But here we introduce this concept, and it's called a graph type. And then we have the concept of graph instances that is basically a mapping between graph types and relational tables. So what we want to do here is we again take our reviews. We edit an artificial email address, which is just the user ID at yelp.com. And Yelp also contains friendship relationships. But here we just assume that this is a separate data set that we call Yelp book, and it just contains the relationships. And those users here in the social network also have the email address. So what we want to do in this example is we take the reviews, we load them from Hive, and we load the relationships from the friendship relationships from Yelp book from H2. And then we use the SQL property graph data source in combination with graph DDL to bring those data sources together into a single property graph and run a query on top of it. So this is basically the DDL part for the graph type. So this is a graph type which is called Yelp. So a graph type always has a name. And within the graph type, you have to specify the concepts that are existing in that graph that you want to use to describe nodes and relationships. So here we have four concepts. We call them element types: user, business, reviews, and friend. And we have to, or we can specify what the properties of those element types are. So for example, user has a name and a since property, and we also have to specify the date. So this is very similar to a create table statement if you know SQL. And then what's also interesting for those element types is that you can extend them. So you have an extension hierarchy. So for example, a user could extend a person. This DDL is basically also part of standardization, ongoing standardization processes that we as Neo4j are involved in. And it basically is the idea of defining how could a schema for a property graph look like. And there's a lots of things going on there. And if you're interested, you can just contact me and I will forward you to the persons responsible for standardization within Neo. So when we define our element types, we can use them to actually define node types and relationship types, which are the node and relationship types that actually occur within the graph. So for example, here, the round parentheses are used to identify or to specify node types. And the element type is then used to say, okay, there are nodes that have element type user, which means they have the label user, which is the name of the element type, and which also means that those nodes all have properties name and since. Other one for the business, you can also imagine like putting multiple element types into those parentheses to basically express multiple inheritance. So you want to extend from multiple element types, and it also means that you inherit all the properties if they are not conflicting. Relationship types basically consist of three parts. It's the start node type, for example, user, the relationship type, reviews, which refers to an element type, and the end node type, business, which also refers to an element type and has to be a defined node type. And then the second part, and here's where it's getting a bit more complicated, is how do we actually map node types to relational systems? So here we are using two relational systems, Hive and H2. We have data source names, namespaces, you can call them like that, Hive and H2. And we basically say, for example, for the user in the first node type mapping, that all the rows that have node label user are coming from table called user, which lives in a database Yelp, which is identified by the namespace Hive. And same for businesses. For the relationship types, it's a bit more complicated. You have to at first specify where is the relationship data stored in. So here we refer to the review table, which is also in the Yelp database under the data source name Hive. And then you have to specify what are the start nodes and what are the end nodes of the relationship, or where do they come from, and how do I join them together. It's very straightforward for the first one. For the second one, this is actually an interesting part, because here the relationship data comes from H2, but the node data is actually coming from Hive, and we specify the join predicates to express that we want to combine those two into a single relationship type. So from a query perspective, you don't see the separation in Hive and H2, you just see your property graph, and you can run a query over reviews and friendship relations, and within the system it basically delegates to H2 and Hive. I will skip the demo. It's part four, so if you want to look it up, it's basically containing a configuration for JDBC and Hive, the DDL that I just described, and a simple query that basically runs on top of the federated graph. Okay, how much time do we have left? Finish, okay. Right, let's do some data science with graphs. So this part of the talk is basically about how we integrate with the Neo4j native graph algorithms. So our team within Neo4j is basically responsible for Morpheus and also for the Neo4j graph algorithms, which is a separate library in the Neo4j database that you can use to run graph algorithms on your Neo4j graph. So things like PageRank, community detection, things like that. And these algorithms are basically part of what we call the Neo4j graph platform. And on the right-hand side is Spark Graph, which is coming to 3.0 that I will talk about later. So this is basically some marketing picture that we use in Neo4j to describe what analytics means for Neo4j. So there are multiple components here. On the top left, for example, there is the, of course, native graph database, Neo4j. We have the Cypher query language that we saw in a lot of examples now. The native graph algorithms, for example, and APOC, which is a collection of stored procedures that you can use to do very interesting things on top of your Neo4j graph. This is basically a detailed version of the slide that Søren showed before. We just saw on the first slide that where you have these different categories of algorithms like pathfinding, centrality, and so on. And what you see here is all the algorithms that are implemented in the Neo4j graph algorithms library. And those that have a little star on the end are also implemented in graph frames, which is the graph algorithm library on Spark, which will also be part of Spark Graph in Spark 3.0. If you're interested in algorithms in general and you want to learn a bit how they are applied in Spark and Neo4j, we recently published a book, which was written by my colleagues, Mark Needham and Amy Hodler. And it's free, you can just download it and learn. And now we will show how we basically integrate Morpheus and Neo4j. What we want to do with our review graph is we want to find trending businesses within the Yelp dataset for our Boulder City subgraph. And we want to use PageRank for this. So PageRank is, I guess, well known. It's an algorithm that you use for if you want to measure influence in a network. Initially invented for measuring websites in the web graph, which is what made Google popular. And it can be used for multiple things like recommendations in Twitter or fraud detection. So what we want to do in this part of the demo is we want to take two of our snapshots out of the library. So you look on the 2017 and 2018 projection of the businesses that co-reviewed our businesses, which was, just to recall, two businesses are connected if they have been reviewed by the same user. We want to use Neo4j and in particular PageRank to compute a PageRank on top of those two graphs. And then by just loading them back into Spark, we want to find out what is the diff between the PageRank of 2018 and 2017 for each business to basically compute something like a trend rank. So an increasing trend rank or a positive trend rank is basically a measure for if the business is becoming more popular. And in order to run this, I will just run one of those two business trends. So what I have done here, I have Neo4j desktop installed, which is a Neo4j database that is running in the background. And I will just start and hope that it works. And again, we have our Morpheus session here, as shown before. This time we need two property graph data sources. The first one is the FS data source that we use to load a snapshot from the local file system into Spark. And then we have a second data source. It's the Neo4j data source, which we can construct with graphsources.cypher.neo4j with a config that contains like bold URLs and authentication stuff under given namespace. And what we do first is we load the two graphs from 2017 and 2018. We basically load them from the file system and store them in Neo4j. So this is basically, this query basically copies the graph from the file system into Neo4j. And now we have the graph in Neo4j, so we can just say neo4j.config with session, which is basically a way to run Cypher queries within Neo4j. So this Cypher query here is executed in Neo4j, not in Spark. And this is the call that you need to run PageRank. So it's call algo.pagerank. We limit the algorithm on a specific set of nodes. We have some PageRank specific properties, like the number of iterations we want to run it, a damping factor. And what's important is that we want to write the PageRank for each node as a new property, which we call PageRank year. So we have PageRank 2017 and PageRank 2018 in this example. And we want to use the review count, which is the number of users that reviewed both businesses, as a weight for the PageRank, which is what we computed in the projection previously. And then when this ran, we basically load the two graphs back into Morpheus. So now we go back from Neo4j and get the data into Spark by just saying from graph Neo4j namespace graph blah 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 2017, give me all the businesses, and then do the same for the 2018 graph, give me all the businesses B2, and basically value join them where the business ID is equal to get to merge them back together. And with those two businesses, B1 and B2, we can compute the trend rank, which is basically the diff between the normalized page rank of 2018 minus the normalized page rank of 2017. And we construct a new graph that contains only the businesses, and we add the trend rank property to them. And in the last query, we basically just say from this resulting graph, give me all the businesses and order them by trend rank. And I want to see the top 10, which is basically the output here. So you see the normalized page rank is between 0 and 1, which is what we needed to do in order to make it nice. And it's basically sorted. Right, so if you're in Boulder City next time, you should go to Southwest Diner. Right, which brings us to the next example. I won't show the code for this one. It's basically similar. What we do here is we use Louvain modularity, which is a community detection algorithm, to detect communities in our social network. And then we use Chakar similarity, which is not a graph algorithm, it's just a set similarity algorithm to find out if two sets are equal. It's basically the intersect divided by the union of two sets. And those two algorithms are basically used to create community-centric recommendation, which means we take our third projection that we had in the beginning, which was a user is co-reviewed with another user, which means they review the same business. And we also have the original user reviews business relationship. We call algo.louvain to detect communities. We run this algorithm just on the users and the co-reviews relationship to select or to extract communities. And now we have multiple communities, and for each of those communities, we find similar users within the communities, and users are similar if they reviewed the same businesses. And then if we detected similar users, which means that we create a new relationship between them, user is similar to other user, we use this relationship in order to recommend businesses to users where similar users have reviewed a business the first user has not yet reviewed. I will not show it in detail how this looks like, but just to show that this is basically also very straightforward. We again copy from file system to Neo4j. This is what we use to call Louvain. The call is very similar to the PageRank call. It just has less properties here. Then we find a similar user. So we have the community number, which is kind of the number of communities we found. And for each of those communities, we create similar users. So they are similar if they reviewed, similar is 0.5, and then at the end we basically run a query over similar users to find out the recommendations for users. Okay, so let's talk a little bit at the end about Spark 3.0 and what we are doing there. So which is the right pillar in this graph analytics picture and Neo4j. So there is a so-called SPIP, which is Spark Project Improvement Proposal, which we, I thought, designed or wrote in December last year. And it has been voted to, or has been accepted by the community, I think, end of at the beginning of February. And since then, we are kind of in the design process and also POC implementations for bringing this into Spark 3.0. Actually, today, we were meeting with some collaborators from Databricks to talk about about how to move forward and what are the best steps here. And so the goal of this SPIP is basically to have a property graph abstraction in Spark that is built on top of data frames, on top of Spark SQL. The SPIP also replaces graph frames, which means that all algorithms that are available in graph frames will be part of this Spark graph project. So you have Cypher querying plus the graph algorithms from Spark. And right. And so what we are trying to do here, we want to start simple, which means in the first version of Spark Graph, we will have Cypher support for Cypher 9, which means all the fancy features like running on multiple graphs won't be available in the first version. But over time, we want to introduce them. But we wanted to keep it as simple as possible to begin with. And so in the first version, like I said, Cypher 9, which means you can run on a property graph and you get the tabular result out of the query. And we want to migrate graph frames into Spark Graph, as already said. And to answer the previous question again, we will provide also Python APIs and, of course, Scala and Java. What are we not solving? Maybe the namespace question was coming from this direction. We won't support RDF. So we are focusing on the property graph model as we described it previously. Like I said, no Cypher 10 multiple graph features and no property graph catalog. There's currently a PR open on Spark, which is basically a proof of concept implementation of our current design. It's a running implementation. You can already create node frames and relationship frames, which is very similar to the concept of node table and relationship table. And you can run Cypher queries and get tabular results. And the cool thing about this is that we designed the Cypher support in Spark Graph in a way that it is API compatible with Morpheus, which means that you can run Spark queries in Spark directly. But if you think that you want to have support for Cypher 10 or you want to have support for a property graph catalog, you can basically switch out the dependency from Spark Cypher, which is the module name in Spark Graph, with Morpheus to get those extra functionality. The one in the middle, I didn't talk about that a lot. We call it Okapi. It's also part of OpenCypher, and it's basically the upper layer where we translate a Cypher query into relational operations, which is totally independent from Spark. It translates to relational operations on an abstract table, which means that you can use it to implement your own backend. For example, as we did for Spark or for Apache Flink, you can imagine something else. Right, that's basically it. Thanks for your time. Took a bit longer than expected, but yeah, hope it was interesting.
Do you have a slide that has where the links are for this presentation?
A slide with all the links. I think we will just send it to the organizers. I think I don't have a slide.
You can come to the page and send it in an email.
Yeah. I will send it in an email and they will put it up on the page. And there's like there's also a video of the, or it will be published on the Spark Summit website, I think this week or next week at some point. And then you have the 90 minutes versions of this talk, which is a bit more detailed than what I explained today. Any more questions? Cool, yeah, thanks.